Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this episode with another new face in Scottish professional wrestling, someone who I got to see their debut very recently at that event where I had a good old breakdown afterwards in our 150th episode. I am joined on this edition by Rhys Dawkins. Welcome.
Oh, hello, William. Sorry, I didn't see you there. I was reading some lines from Coriolanus from my book of Shakespeare plays. Always good to go back and go over the classics.
Always good to go over the
Coriolanus.
That's the one. It's very weird to be called William. I will get called William when I'm in trouble.
I will do my best to, it does say Billy at the bottom, I'll do my best to avoid it, but I do like a little bit of culture, a little bit of decorum. So I usually go for first names, but I'll do my best.
I don't mind at all. I've had chats in the past. A man called Thatcher Wright, I spoke to him and he exclusively called me William. I hated him for 40 minutes, but no, that was just because he was a Tory.
An easy person to hate, I understand.
Yes, he is. So welcome to the show. I'm glad to
Thank you for having me.
Before I'll wrap up and go be a grown up for a bit. And then by the time January rolls around next year, I'll be like itching to speak to everyone again.
Oh, absolutely. I can imagine. So much will have changed in that time, of course.
Absolutely. By the time I get you back on, you'll have a belt over your shoulder. I don't know which one, but...
It could be any of them. I feel like I could fit easily into any of the divisions that we have at WrestleZone.
Absolutely. So we'll go to the classics then. Speaking of classics, with the Coriolanus. Yes. Didn't take me long. Classic questions. First off, it's just a boring cliche question, but it's a nice icebreaker. What got you pro wrestling? So what was the moment you watched? What got you hooked on it?
So when I was a younger lad, my family used to take care of my niece quite often. And we had to find ways to keep her entertained. And one of the ways we did that was we got Just Bring It on the PlayStation 2 because she was a big wrestling fan. And I think I have vague memories of Kane being the big thing because he was cool and he had the mask. And the first show I watched was New Year's Revolution 2005. It was recorded on a VHS and I watched that. And there was no moment where I was like, oh, this is something that I'm going to love forever. It was, this is something I enjoy. I enjoyed it until about 2009, 2010, when we got rid of Sky Sports because we were trying to save money. I watched TNA for a bit and I enjoyed what I watched, but then it changed channel as well after like a month and I wasn't going to go out of my way to try and find it again. No disrespect to TNA, I enjoyed what I watched. And then I think it was 2016, I think it was WrestleMania 32. I'd been watching YouTube channels that went more into the part of wrestling that's more theatrical, as it were, of course, with my connection to Shakespeare. The parts, the more internal aspects of wrestling as opposed to external, as it were. And that's what really hooked me in again. I still played like the games like WWE 13, I believe I played a lot of. But that's what really got me back into it. And then watching WrestleMania 32, when Zack Ryder won the Intercontinental Championship in the ladder match, I lost my mind. And that was when I sort of decided this is something that I can stick with for a good long time. And so far I have.
So there's a lot to work with. I have so many questions on as we go along. So Just Bring It then. First game I played on the PS2. I remember that game.
A classic console.
It was I'm after one. I keep looking for one now because I've got a PS3, but this is the newer style of
those
them.
That you can't. Yeah.
So you can't play the PS2 games.
I'm very lucky in that my partner had a PS2. So when we moved into the house, we just took that with us. So when I had COVID during the Regal Rumble, I played a lot of my old wrestling games, like Just Bring It, like I think the first SmackDown versus Raw. That's what kept me entertained whilst I was in quarantine.
Nice. I'm starting to like build. Every time I go into cash exchange at the moment, I kind of pick up an old WWE game just to have it there, just ready, waiting for a PS2 to arrive. Because you know, got to save some money as well.
Of course,
back in the day. But so every time I see a PS2, I'm like, I'm not going anything over like 20. I can't go over 20 because it's a PS2, and folk are going, oh, give me 50 quid for it. Like, no. I can get a new PS3.
It's a bit steep, yes.
I can get a PS3 for 60. Settle yourself. I'll just like let me get a PS2. I Shut Your Mouth and Here Comes the Pain as well. I've got that, that hanging
that's a
about.
Good one as well, certainly.
But no, I love those games and I like the somewhat the younger people that I speak to. It seems to be either video games that seem to get them into it. And you said the inside baseball, as Jeff Jarrett would call it, kind of stuff, like your woke cultures and what
precisely
happened.
What culture was the primary one, yes.
Woke culture seems to, was it back in the day where it's the cultaholic guys that were hosting?
Yes, primarily, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was, I can't remember the first video I watched. I'm sure it was a list video. And I'm just like, oh, okay. So it finding out more of the inside information and finding out how that can be used to tell stories and things like that was perfect for getting me back into it after finding my love for Shakespeare and finding my love for theater and things like that. The storytelling is the real crux of my love of pro wrestling is the storytelling.
That's I mean, I've often said when I'm speaking to other guests that I'm finding nowadays that's my kind of style. That's what I like. I love a good bit of wrestling. I don't mind it.
Of
like
course,
a,
yes.
a good bit of rolling about and all that kind of stuff. But give me a story, and I'm probably going to be okay with it. I mean, like with WrestleZone is a perfect example.
Exactly, it's certainly.
Like if you got a Sisto match, I'll be super excited for a Sisto match, or a Super Executioner is probably a better example in that respect, because I'm just mad for the Super Executioner.
The Super Executioner is an interesting fellow, most certainly, yes.
But it's not wrestling. It's not wrestling
in
the like technical term, but it's just
not your Shawn Michaels, Kurt Angle, WrestleMania 21. It's
no
Super Executioner.
Exactly. I mean, I
wouldn't have it any other way.
Exactly. I mean, in Ellen, I was highly entertained by just Executioner on one corner, Swift on the other corner, shouting at each other. And I thought that was the most fun thing ever. So, you know, wrestling's subjective, I suppose that's the whole thing. So, yeah, went from that. Then you took your break and got back in. But speaking of the woke culture, guys, I never got into woke culture at the time. I don't know why. But as soon as Cultaholic came around, I was like...
Mm-hmm. Cultaholics, they've really streamlined their process, I think. The one thing they do that annoys me, this may be a pet peeve, is now when they do a list video, they don't have a little, and that was the video, to end it off. It just kind of stops. And that really frustrates me. Because I'm like, you should have like a sign-off. Because I don't know that the video's ended. Then my phone has just stopped for whatever reason. As opposed to knowing this is the end of the video. So it's just like, oh, now it's done. Very strange. I'm sure that's just a pet peeve of mine, but it does my head in.
Right, we'll have a sign off. It's just incredibly awkward if anyone's listened to any other
fine.
Episode.
Don't worry about it.
It's one of those where I think I'll try to think of something really clever to end it, and it means just me going, "All right, end meeting."
Luckily, I have a fantastic little speech from William Shakespeare that I can use to end it off if you so wish.
Wonderful. That I look forward to that. This is amazing because the next episode that's coming out after this, we've got poetry as well with Brody Adler. So this is going to be a nice little collection of episodes. But the difference is you're willing to do the Shakespeare. I had to coerce her into doing poetry.
Absolutely. I do. I've made no qualms about my love of Shakespeare. Absolutely not.
So you took your break, and was that when you kind of discovered your love for theater and Shakespeare?
Yes, primarily. I was doing a lot of theater when I was in academy or secondary school, as some might know it. It was more so something I just did actually, my granddad, who we recently remembered him, he passed away a year ago, and we recently remembering him. The first moment that I really remember being interested in theatre was I walked into their house, and he said to me, "Is there a book? This is the book you're needing from the library, Jack." And I was like, "My name's not Jack." And then he said, no, this is for the panto I'm doing at the church. I'm like, oh, what's up? The panto? You can do that? And then I eventually got involved the following year in the panto. And then it all sort of spiraled down from there, doing drama a lot in secondary school, eventually going on to college to study acting and performance to now, essentially.
For a moment, I thought your granddad was just doing a really spot on Hulk Hogan impression, you know? There's a book in E, Jack.
No. Although, no, I don't think he knew who Hulk Hogan was.
You never know. He may have liked Gremlins 2, the new batch.
Was Hulk Hogan and Gremlins 2?
I'm sure he's in Gremlins 2. You know, like the Gremlins take over like a theater, a movie theater, and then Hulk Hogan gets up and then tells them off, and then they leave. I vaguely
remember that now. It has been a while since I've watched Gremlins 2, to be fair.
Yeah, that's probably the highlight, to be honest, of Gremlins 2. Yeah, it's a Christmas staple in this household when I get to watch it. That and Last Action Hero and Jingle All the Way. You know, the classics.
Oh, absolutely.
I get them all in there. So when it came to theater, then was there anything that like you fell in love with it? Was there anything in particular that works that you enjoyed? Maybe other than Shakespeare, was there any other kind of works that you were drawn to?
A lot of contemporary work interests me a lot. There was a play we did called Oh, I can't remember the name of it now. That's terrible. It's gone completely out of my brain. Well, in any case, we did a performance of Animal Farm in our last year, and at first I didn't really enjoy it, because how do you perform like an animal? How do you really get into the animal state? And eventually there was a moment where it all just clicked, and I was like, oh, I'm a dog now. I just watched my dog doing stuff, and I'm like, that, okay, I'll just take that on then. I'll do that. I yawned like a dog. I barked. I sat my legs like this, because that's how my dog sat. Physicality is a really good, important thing in theater, and really embodying the characters that you are being portrayed, even if they are a dog, if they're a fairy in the case of Shakespeare, or if they're just a person who's from a different place than you. We did a lot of accent training in I think my last year, and that was something I really enjoyed, was doing accents. Eventually, you know, you swing around. I've also enjoyed doing musicals, which I thought I would probably enjoy, but it's very elaborate. It's very theatrical. It's very flamboyant, almost. It's very wrestling.
Absolutely. I mean, last one, I went to see Book of Mormon at the start of June.
I've heard that's quite good, yes.
It was surprising. I mean, I found out why they only really play the first song when they do like TV stuff very quickly, because wow. I mean, I enjoyed it, but it's not one of those where my mum asked, oh, do you think I'd enjoy it? No, you would not.
Most certainly. There's another good song in it that I cannot remember the name of now. Oh, it's in my audition playlist.
Is it Clean?
No. Oh, darn it. One second.
We'll find out. I'm
no look this up. Now. Going on Spotify. Do apologize. Just vamp. Just vamp for me, William.
It's fine. No, it's fine. Yeah, but it was just so incredibly rough. And but no, my mum's quite, she's not religious per se, but she's like, I think she believes something's there, you know?
Yeah,
something's watching over us, kind of thing.
I Believe was the name of the song.
Oh, right. Okay. Okay. Yeah,
that's a bit of a cleaner one. Yeah,
it's definitely. I mean, there's ones where they're calling God all manner of names. It's just it's incredible. So I was about to ask about musicals then, because that's, when it comes to like theater stuff, that's more my side of things that I enjoy.
I feel like it's most the easiest one to get other people involved in. For people who don't necessarily like theater, musicals is the sort of thing you can all enjoy, because you have your jukebox musicals like Mamma Mia, where people can just go to enjoy the music. But then you've got other ones, like I was in a production of Full Monty, which the story is actually much deeper than you think. And it's actually a really nice story of people coming together and, you know, working to do something together, and the bond that forms when you're kind of thrown into a strange situation, which you wouldn't expect from the Full Monty.
Did you do the Full Monty? Wow. I mean,
there are people who have seen Rhys Dawkins. Well, we had the backlight, but the backlight only did so much, as it were.
I mean, it was a small backlight, I'm sure. So yeah. Yeah, because like some musicals, Hairspray is probably one of my favorites. I've got like a list that I want to see before, you know, I die, I suppose. So it's a very small list. And I can't think of it. Bucket list. We'll go bucket list. Bucket list.
Bucket list of musicals.
Yeah, and it's well, like, I think five. I think it's on there that I'm just I'm can't seem to get crossed off. It's Hairspray, Jersey Boys, which I was supposed to see in July, and then they cancelled their Aberdeen dates.
As happened a lot these past couple of years, things have been cancelled.
I was gutted by, because it was on my birthday as well, so I was excited to go. Wicked, love to see Wicked.
I've seen Wicked, it's excellent. I've seen it twice now.
It's just the music. I just enjoy the music. I kind of can guess most of the story, but like, just the music's excellent. Yes. Hamilton, I want to see Hamilton.
Yes, of course.
Can't remember. I think Lion King may be in there. There's something else as well, but Lion King, I kept getting told I need to go see, because it's just incredible to
a visual masterpiece, as I understand it. Yeah.
Yeah. So musicals is, again, any particular favorites out there? Any ones that you said, so you've got a Book of Mormon song on your audition playlist. Is there any other musicals out there that you like?
A lot of the songs from the audition playlist are musicals I've not seen. Like there's Santa Fe from Newsies. I did see Rent. I enjoyed that. There's also Rest in Peace from Buffy the Vampire Slayer, when they did the musical episode of that.
Oh.
I saw Les Mis when I was down in London, and that was an excellent show. Just, there's nothing like that. Oh, picking a favorite. It's like picking for your favorites from your children. I'll say Les Mis, but I'm not confident on that. That's not that would probably change tomorrow.
It's one of those. I find Les Mis is one you got to be in the mood for.
Yes, that is heavy, and it's more of an opera than a musical because it just goes all the way through. There's no breaks, like Hamilton in a way. Hamilton's more operatic because it's just all the way through.
Yeah. Tick Tick Boom is another one I enjoyed really recently that came out.
I've heard of that.
On
I haven't
Netflix.
Seen it.
I was in full on Andrew Garfield mode because, you know, there was the heavy rumor that he was going to be in Spider-Man, and I won't spoil that for anyone that's listening to this and hasn't
surely that's past the
I know, but you never know. There's going to be someone sitting there going, oh, I haven't seen it. I'm going to wait until I get the Blu-ray.
And then
I haven't seen it. So I will neither confirm nor deny if Andrew Garfield is in Spider-Man. Was it No Way Home? No Way Home. That's the one.
Yes, No Way Home.
Amazing. Right. So we'll come back onto things like Shakespeare and that. We'll get into a little bit more back into your wrestling journey.
Yes, sir.
As well. So when you go back into it, so WrestleMania 32, you saw Zack Ryder win the Intercontinental Championship. And was Zack Ryder just a guy that did you watch Z Long Island Story? I don't think I did.
I think I just really liked him from the games because he was goofy. And he seemed to be having fun whenever he was doing anything. And I think I am also a really big fan of underdogs. And I think because Zack Ryder just has that underdog energy, that when I saw him win the big one, I'm like, oh, yes, this is fantastic. This is amazing. And then he lost the next night.
Oh, yeah. To The Miz, of course. That was and of course, ladder matches. I mean, I've found apparently ladder matches are like a bit Marmite. Either you love them or you don't. I didn't realize that until I met my wife, and she went, I don't get it. I don't understand that why they can run up 1 second and then they've got to like go up one time. I was like, don't spoil the logic.
I should say it's just wrestling.
Stop adding logic into this. That's damn joy.
It's like theater. You think and you're like, why would the fairies do that? That doesn't make any sense. Of course it doesn't make sense. It's not. It's to forward the story, the same way that ladder matches do.
Like next second, though, we'll watch a rumble and she'll be like, oh, this is the best thing ever. It's like, right, okay, you got to pick a lane here. You got to either believe it all or don't.
Yes.
Just go on. Just, it's not real. I mean, it is real, but it's
of course, yes.
Real in our minds. So you go back into then. So Zack Ryder ends up properly when it just,
That was pretty much at that point I was all in. I think not long after that, I'm sure this was a question that was going to come up. Not long after that, there was a WrestleZone show in Ellen, and that was the first WrestleZone show I went to. And funnily enough, you mentioned him earlier, Sisto was a guy I really enjoyed, again, because he was goofy and he's stupid. And I looked up to him and I went, I love you. And he just went like that to me. And I'm like, this is what wrestling's all about. It's the fan interaction, weirdly. And then I'm like, okay, I'm just following this company now. This is just the way it is.
Well, welcome to the... So when was that then? Ellen, what year?
I think it was 2016. Let me look at it. I do actually have a photo from that event. I was doing this earlier. I was looking for moments that I could have visual... Let me see.
See if I can
it doesn't
the
have
results.
The date because I saved it. I'm pretty sure it was 2016 March. I think that's the photo I took with then tag team champions, Caden Garrick and Mr. P.
Oh, nice. So I must be around about the same time that they were doing like their Keith run and stuff like that, because
possibly yes,
because they were champions when I interviewed them for the very first podcast I ever did, which was terrible, but you know,
your first is always awful. You get better with time.
You'd think that, but no, I'm gonna find it because I'm more curious in the results now. It's 20.
Mr. P versus Lord Mr. Malice was also on that event. There was supposed to be, I believe it was a tag team match between the Sterling Brothers and Scotty Swift and Brian Tucker, but Brian Tucker was taken out before the show, and Johnny Lyons had to replace him. Johnny Lyons had a different match on that show, but I can't remember what it was.
What a memory. So this is a card from...
This is how you know it impacted me in a big way. It's because I remember so much of the show.
I used to remember my first ever show, and as years have gone on, I'm like,
oh, of course,
were they on it? And was he on it? And I can never remember now, but I still remember my first WrestleZone one, which was like 6 months afterwards, which was the first beach ballroom. Right, so for anyone that is curious, because that's the kind of person I'd be, Mickey Vago defeats Blue Thunder in the opener. And we've got Chris Archer defeating Sisto. Caden Garrick defeating Alan Sterling. This sounds amazing. At the time, it would have been Sir Andrew Wilde.
Oh, yes. Yeah, I do remember that now, yeah.
defeating Aspen Faith and Johnny Lyons. Give me that match again. I will watch
play that back
anytime. Mr. P defeating Lord Mr. Malice, mm-hmm. and Damien and Sean Johnson against defeating Johnny Lyons and Scotty Swift.
It was Sterling Oil, not the Sterling Brothers. Yes.
Oof, that sounds like a cracker of a show.
You can tell why I stuck around.
Oh, absolutely, because as I've said, like I've spoke with Scotty in the past, and like they seem really good at structuring a show which mm-hmm. has a little bit of everything. Because you got your Sisto, you got your Lord Mr. Malice, and at the time it was Sterling Oil, so you had Serious Allen, which it doesn't matter what iteration of Alan Sterling you get.
Alan Sterling is an excellent professional. The captain is an excellent professional wrestler.
Oh, absolutely. I love mixed martial Alan. That's a personal favorite out there, but you can't go wrong. And then you've got Andy Wild, Aspen Faith, mm-hmm. and Johnny Lyons in that main event. Oh, just, yeah. I'm getting chills.
Sad you missed it.
I'm very sad I missed it. But at that point, I think, how old have I been? 25? I was like paying for the, If I was getting to Anarchy, I was lucky that point, you know, because travel and, you know, pennies. But I went to my first Ellen one this year, my first mm-hmm. Ellen show, and I couldn't believe how like loud the show was and how great the show was. Because
Ellen is a very big crowd for wrestling, which surprises me, being from Ellen, where there is nothing to do. I think that's why they're so big, because like, oh, something's happening. So everyone's like, let's go to this thing that's happening, because nothing happens in Ellen.
Oh, I found that out very quickly when I got to Ellen.
Yes.
Yeah, I was like, right, what can I do? I'll get there, because it was snowing, so I was like, all right, I'm going to get there in good time. Got there 2 hours early, because I gave myself an extra hour and a half to kind of travel, because I used to live in New Pitsligo, so it's like I know mm-hmm. how to get there. Just I know it's back roady and a bit mm-hmm. rubbish. But no, when I got there, I was like, right, what I'm going to do? I'm going to find somewhere to eat for a priority. Find somewhere to go to the toilet, which was harder than you think it would have been.
It's surprisingly difficult.
It was, yes, it was. I pretty much I had to sit in the car and wait until the doors open for the Victoria Hall, because I was like, oh god, if I stand up for any length of time in this cold, I am.
If you go to there's a small bar next to it, the Legion. They have a loose there, but I cannot remember how you get in besides ringing the doorbell and someone else letting you in, or my parents have little cards that you like.
Mm-hmm. Disabled ones, like, kind of thing. Yeah,
something like that. Then you can go in that way.
Yeah, So I was just like, right, okay, what can I do to kill time? Went to the Chippy and had that, and went around. We've got like a sort of Saturday market. I end up just going around.
Would have been on that day. That's another thing where people are like, oh, things are happening. So they go to the market on the Saturdays or whatever. The galas are usually pretty busy as well.
Yeah, so I found stuff to do, but yeah, it was all about the show. And yeah, I couldn't believe how, yeah, like you're saying, how hot it was and how many people that were there. And mm-hmm. It just made me appreciate when I put out in the review kind of thing, going, if you can get to a show, just go.
Yeah.
Because you're going to enjoy it. It's mm-hmm. it's mental. It's just good fun. Mm-hmm. So Ellen 2016 is when you started your WrestleZone mm-hmm. journey. Mm-hmm. Were you trying to get to most shows you could get to? Was there any
as I could? Yes, I think I missed that year's Regal Rumble, because the show before, which I also missed, was the double pin with Scott and Scott. Oh no, was that the following year? That might have been 2017. That might not have been 2016.
I think, yeah.
Because Andy Wild was champion at the point.
I missed the Rumble that year, I think the year after, and it had the double.
I remember distinctively thinking, why don't they put the belt on in the Rumble? Why have this separate match? And then why not, like 1992 WWE, just put the belt title on in the Rumble. But they didn't, and yeah, that's fine by me. Good way to keep the things going until the Anarchy that year. I think that was the one with Rikishi. I think it was 2017's Rumble I missed.
Right, because I'm looking at 2016's one, Crusher one. So yeah, you're right, and you're thinking it was the year after, because mm-hmm. because Andy was still Sir Andrew Wild at that point.
That's what made me think that I was incorrect on that. Yeah.
Yeah, and then he had that weird triple threat. Rikishi, because he got stink face, I think.
I remember that was the first Anarchy that I went to in 2017. I also have this picture of a young Zach Dynamite. From, I think it was Stonehaven or something like that. From a young Zach Dynamite, before he became the Undisputed Champion, you know, one of the best wrestlers in Scotland. He was just a young lad taking photos with fans.
I like that you can keep these memories and mementos. I'm incredibly awkward with people, so I have very few pictures of wrestlers. And if I do, it's usually like the ones I've had to pay £10 for.
I usually was, but I think wrestling helped me come out of my shell a lot. Mm-hmm. So I was more confident going up to Mr. P and Kane Garrick and eventually Zach Dynamite to get these pictures. I think that was it. Those two. It's the only ones I could find.
I'm sure maybe once you're the champion, there'll be all these little
of course,
come
yes,
out
absolutely.
Of the woodwork going, this is when the Undisputed Champion was getting a picture with Sisto way back when.
They also had a show. It was the fan event at Inverurie. I took a lot of photos then, but I think I was training by that point. So they kind of knew me a little bit more.
All right. Okay. So how did you get into actual training then? So you saw the match, you saw the Zack Ryder thing. You thought, mm-hmm. I want to do this. You saw WrestleZone and you're like, okay, I've got a local scene now. Mm-hmm.
I think
how did you get into training?
A year, maybe? No. It was about April 2017. I kind of realized, oh, they have a training academy. So I applied and I was accepted, obviously. And I believe, I'm almost 100% certain on this, my debut this year was 5 years exactly since I started training. 15th of May. I'm almost 100% certain of it.
I like that kind of, like...
It's a story that builds itself, almost.
Exactly. Yeah, you worked for 5 years to get it. Even though we had, like, that weird...
You're missing with COVID. I also lost half a year from breaking my leg at training in 2019.
Did you do commentary with your broken leg?
I did do commentary in 2019 with my broken leg, yes.
I remember.
I think you spoke to me at that event, yeah.
I must have, yeah. Well, it must have been a rare time that I spoke to anyone at a wrestling show. Must be the same time I spoke to Evan Young for the first time. Must have been on it that day. I was
possibly,
like, I'm going to speak to all the people.
it was during the PAC signing meet and greet thing. I obviously had my broken leg, so I had to kind of stay out. I was going to say security, but I don't think I would have been excellent security with the broken leg. But I was just sort of, it was nice to see people interacting with Pac and seeing him interact with fans. And you and I, of course, had a chat very briefly, I think.
Yeah. Pac is one of those weird ones where he was like really nice to you and we mm-hmm. spoke away. And then as soon as you got the camera out to get a picture, his face just dropped.
Yes, immediately. Yeah.
And it was like, oh, that's ace. You're amazing. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you don't want to turn around and go, oh, you're just amazing. No, but seeing that. So, right, go back to your training then. You got accepted and you got to find out where this secret building was, because for years it was all like hush hush where WrestleZone Training
Academy was. I'm sure they've mentioned it before. They mentioned the Scout Hut in previous interviews. I missed the Scout Hut. I was essentially one of the first, as I understand it, I was one of the first people to start training purely at the Academy, as I understand it.
Right. Okay. So how did you find your first? Well, actually, before that, you said you had a bit of a theater background. You have a theater background, mm-hmm. so you got the character side probably kind of
very
molded already.
That was the part that I knew I would be the most confident with, is the character, the being open with a crowd, being able to take in what they're doing and being able to react off of it. The physical part was the hardest part for me because I hated physical education when I was younger. Glasses, Shakespeare, massive nerd. So the physical part of it was the hardest part for me, mm-hmm. but now getting to where I am now, I'm surprised by how much better I am physically and how longer it takes me to get gassed, even though it's probably faster than it should be. But the time it takes me now, I can feel the progress from where I started to where I am now.
Yeah. I mean, I hate PE as well. Cause you know, glasses. I like chips. I like chips and I don't like running. That's just what's going to happen.
I've heard Conor Malloy and Ronan King speaking about how much they enjoy the gym, and I cannot imagine that. I cannot for a second think, you know what I'm going to do for fun? I'm going to go to the gym and sweat for an hour.
Oh no, I tried one of those, like, there was gym passes going around in Elgin, and I was like, right, we'll sign up, me and my wife, for our wedding. Mm-hmm. We're going to, like, right, we'll sign up, we'll lose some weight. And we did. But it was really because we ate better. It wasn't because of any exercise, because mm-hmm. I did like 3 sessions of running for an hour and I was like, nah. Mm-hmm. No, I'm not enjoying this. I'll do some lifting. Oh, I hate this as well. I'm gonna mm-hmm. do some leg stuff. Nah, hate that. I'm gonna walk. I'll walk to work. There mm-hmm. we go. I worked 10 minutes away. It wasn't that much of a walk, but clearly it made the difference.
Yeah.
Because
sometimes you have to start small and then slowly build it up until you're walking 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, till you're walking for an hour. As I understand it.
Oh yeah, I mean during the pandemic, of course, but there's not much else to do than
yeah. mm-hmm.
the dog probably hated me by the time that mm-hmm. the kind of lockdowns were starting to properly lift, because every weekend me and my dad would go out I'd just do like 10-mile walks and 18-mile walks, and I felt like death. And the dog like was asleep for 3 days. In the following days, looking at me, going, "Don't let me go outside. Don't take me outside. I hate you." But no, you find things to do. But we'll get on to the pandemic stuff soon enough. So you start training. Mm-hmm. You're finding your way with the physical aspect of things. Right, how did you break your leg?
It's not an interesting story. We were doing a drill where you slide in, slide out, go in over the bottom, go in out over the bottom, in over the second, out over the second, in over the top, out over the top. During the out over the bottom, I held onto the rope a little bit too long, maybe went a bit too fast, and just my leg, as it landed, just tweaked the wrong way. I thought I'd only sprained it, and then we got to the hospital. Ryan Riley was kind enough to drive me to the hospital. And they said, "You do know you've broken it." And I said, "Oh no, that's not good. I'm not a fan of that. I think it, not just the impact of the roll going wrong, I think I also injured it before when I was going to do a Western film in Huntley. And I think I twisted it before I left, so I didn't have time to rest it or rehab it because I had these big boots on and I had to do stuff. So I think that probably also contributed to eventually, that was just like the straw that broke the camel's back, to use an analogy.
I think Christian, I remember in the ENC podcast, I think he had quite a similar kind of thing. He just did a roll under and his leg just didn't come with him.
Just goes the wrong way, yeah.
Yeah. But no, that's still at least it's a wrestling injury. And I love the reaction, which is like, oh no, that's not good.
It's pretty, and then it got worse because it wasn't healing correctly. So I had to get a plate inserted into my leg in order for it to grow the correct way so that I could still walk on it. And obviously I'm back and obviously it's all gone well. But there was a moment where I'm like, oh, this is awful.
So, I mean, are you possibly looking into the future using the old Lex Luger metal plate to your advantage?
Oh, I don't think it's large enough for that, unfortunately. I was very excited when I went on my first holiday after receiving it that I would go through the beeping machines and they would go off, and they didn't, and I was very upset. So I'm like, oh, I guess it's just not big enough, or they've sussed it essentially.
I had the same. I broke my elbow, and I was drunk, so I didn't feel it, so it was great. I mean, it wasn't great at the time. But I got two plates in, just two little ones, just to create a corner, because I don't have a proper elbow now. And I was so excited when I was just going down to London, not long, like maybe a year afterwards, going, should I get a doctor's note? Just in case I get patted down, and they want me to strip to my underwear so I can avoid that. But no, I went through, nothing. I was like,
it's a moment of disappointment, isn't it? You're just like, I wanted to cause a scene.
I mean, I don't want to get frisked, but you know, it's still a bit exciting to tell people. Like I've got plates in my arm. It's amazing. I think I was running the same holidays where I somehow walked behind someone going through the check-in and they didn't register me going through. And I
didn't know you were there.
I got all the way to the actual entering the plane before they went, we have no record of you being here. I'm like, I'm very worried that I got this far if you have no record of me.
You need to tighten up your security then, if this has happened.
London Heathrow of all places. Oh my God, how did I get here? You should have noticed. I had to wait until they went through like hours of CCTV to find me. Like on fast forward, I'm like, oh, it's fine. You're definitely supposed to be here. I know I'm supposed to be here, but
I've got my ticket. Thank you very much.
Again, I don't have a bomb on me, but you know, I still shouldn't be here if you didn't find me. The plate thing, that makes me laugh because it was exactly the same. I was so excited to get like beep beep beep. Oh, I've got a plate, and then nothing at all. One day maybe, just in the
one
hope.
Day the security will get worse, and it will be for any metal that goes through. You go through, you've got calcium in your bones. It's going off.
I know, I've got, I mean, I had a good thing at iron beforehand, an iron tablet, and registered a bit, and that's it. I'm just metal all over. So you're back from, how did you kind of cope then during your leg break? Were you just watching wrestling, watching training, or was that when you really properly got into the commentary side of things?
That was, the commentary began in, you know, I've got another photo for you, William. Let me bring this up. Aberdeen Anarchy 2018, my first commentary job,
of course.
And beautiful then event. Mostly it was just trying to rehab, just trying to find things to entertain myself, I think quarantine affected me, or lockdown, I should say, affected me less than most people because I'd already had 6 months where I didn't have to, I had nothing to do. I had to stay in my house. Or I stayed at my partner's house because she had a downstairs toilet, which we didn't have at my home in Ellen. So that was stressful. That was rough. I mostly just played video games, I'll be honest. I completed GTA 5. I beat most of the Batman games that were on Xbox. Wrestling sort of took it. Every now and again, I would chat with one of the guys, and eventually we sometimes do these promo nights. I don't know if that's been mentioned at the training academy, and that was my first time coming back. Eventually, once I was able to walk on the what are they called, crutches. Thank you. And that was the first time I came back, and I got a massive ovation when I came in. Obviously, so that was kind of, it was mostly sort of promo stuff until eventually I could come all the way back.
So video games then, I know for myself during lockdown, yeah, I got bad into the Lego games. That seemed to be my my thing. But no, GTA 5, I couldn't ever get into the GTA games. I know it's very popular, not, clearly.
Yeah, certainly.
Especially when they've spanned over three consoles and it's the same game.
That's very impressive to me. It's like Skyrim, they just continue to roll out like very minor updates, but people, the games are that good, so people come back to them.
I know, it's like Star Wars special editions. It's like, we re-released the original trilogy. We've added 2 minutes of extra content. Yes, let's buy that then.
I remember hearing that one of the Lord of the Rings special editions, the only thing that's added is a short scene with a cat. But I don't know how true that is, because my partner would disagree.
I hate Lord of the Rings.
That's a hot take. I also am not. I'm not a massive fan. I like Lord of the Rings as a concept, the fantasy setting. Yeah. I really enjoy, but the Lord of the Rings films themselves have put me to sleep on more than one occasion.
Yeah. I've never got through all of them all at once, like at all. I just find them so mind-numbingly boring. But like Star Wars, I can give or take. It's not a deal breaker if I never watch any of them ever again. But no, Lord of the Rings, just I like a little bit more sci-fi than that kind of side of things. Sci-fi fantasy over walking around in grass.
High fantasy, dragons, etc.
Yeah, but really it's just Marvel. Marvel's probably my kind of zone.
Marvel's certainly a large one, yes.
Yeah. So you got back. So we'll go back to the commentary then. How did you get into that then? Was it just needed someone to fill in for a night? You were available? How would you
essentially
get into
that? Because I'd done so well in like the promo nights that we did, or the promo segments that we did, where we basically, it was, they knew that I could talk. So when, of course, Team WrestleZone versus Team Sterling Oil, of course, there was an individual who used to do commentary, was taken out of that, was in that match. So they had a hole to fill. So they said, oh, Rhys, would you be willing to do the commentary for Aberdeen Anarchy? And I'm like, absolutely. I'm not going to turn down an opportunity to essentially work the biggest show of the year for WrestleZone. And eventually that individual had to step away or left. I can't exactly remember. So I just essentially took over that role for good until eventually, you know, transitioning into the role I have now.
But no, I remember that event. It was, I mean, all the beach ballroom shows, it was like over 1,000 people. So not that you were like front of like people could see you so much, but yes, you were still on the stage. So if anyone came out or anyone was up at the stage, then you were still there. And I suppose that's kind of water off duck's back at this point for you, because of course you have done theater and plays and all that kind of stuff.
Yes, it would have, I think if it had been most other people, they may have been spooked by it, but for me it was essentially just, oh, it's just like a full theater performance that will last from as soon as fans come in to when fans leave, essentially.
Was there any commentators that you kind of tried to draw any inspiration from when you were doing it? Anyone that you kind of watched to get some cadence from, or did you kind of just try and do your own style?
Mostly I try and do my own thing. When I was taking my break, I played a lot of the WWE games, like I mentioned. Sometimes I would just have two creative wrestlers or two wrestlers just have a match, and I would just commentate over it just for fun. So I had some practice commentating, even though it was just for me, basically. I don't think there was anyone in particular I tried to emulate or tried to. I basically just tried to be me and tried to bring my knowledge and my expertise to the ring, as it were.
Now I see where because of course during the lockdown, I did tournaments. I also did some 2K20 stuff.
Yes,
well,
you did.
I put out two nights of Aberdeen Anarchy are the nights it should have been, and I don't have the videos anymore, and I'm gutted. I think I'll have yours somewhere because I still have a commentary for it. But no, I asked you if you would do commentary for a match, and you were like, yeah. I was like, now I know that you've had experience doing that anyway.
Oh, of course, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And that was like, such a cool thing, because I thought it was... Because there's nothing to do at this point. There was no shows to go to, nothing to write about, no results. Mm-hmm. So tried to fill my days, and I was so glad that so many people were just on board with this lunacy of doing
things. We were all the same. We were all stir crazy. So we're like, we'll do something. We'll placate William's escapades.
Yeah, just everyone just encouraged me at WrestleZone at this point. And there's always days where I'm like, is this just for their laughs, or are they actually supporting me? But I know it's the latter over, but you know, you get those mental days where you go,
of course, yes.
They're just taking the mick out of me. But no, it was just so cool that, like I said, you were up for it, and you got it to me very quickly as well. Again, experience was probably
of course.
Was that one take?
I don't recall. I'm going to lie and say yes, because it makes me look better.
Absolutely. So we got that, and and then from there, shows were coming back, and eventually, and like I say, you kind of had you're still kind of recovering from your hiatus for your leg and what have you. Mm-hmm. So what was it like finally getting back into proper training, actually doing the physicality again?
It was a struggle at first to sort of get back into, because of course the physical part was the part I struggled with when I started. So basically coming back to that, not quite from square one, but from square six or so, that was getting back into it was the struggle. But then once I kind of got into it, it seemed like I got a lot better. A lot of people have said they got better when they were away from COVID. I kind of got better when I was away with my leg. I think because I had more time to think, I had more time to compartmentalize and sort of put the inner workings together in my head a bit more. So when eventually we came back, my brain was more wired for wrestling, even if the physicality wasn't quite there, until eventually the physicality got to the point where they sort of almost matched.
I mean, I suppose during that time, if you are watching wrestling, you can't physically do it. I assume now at that point you were training, you had a bit more of a logical thought when you're watching matches, like watching the footwork, watching this bit. And then
exactly, yeah.
If you were still physically able to train at that point, you would try to just do it straight away the next week, or try to implement this. But at least you had that time to go, right, I'm going to watch this, watch that. Oh, they've done it a little bit differently. Mm-hmm. Then you can try and strike a balance that works with your brain precisely. As well. Mm-hmm. And able to just dive in. When the shows are coming back, though, how excited were you? So it's Halloween Hijinks would have been the first show back.
Halloween Hijinks. I saw the as the card was going up, I'm like, it's so good to finally be back and be able to just do all this again. There was obviously the worry, of course, because, you know, COVID hasn't gone away. It still hasn't. But the precautions were all taken. We were all testing every training session. Before the show, we were all testing. You know, it was all very safe and very above board, and it was just finally good to be able to put on something that's going to entertain people again.
And before that as well, you in the run up to it, you debuted Talking Dawkins.
Yeah, that was to I think I actually did that after Halloween Hijinks. I think it was for Christmas Chaos. Yes,
right. Okay.
It was to sort of, because I'd been away, and to sort of, I remembered listening to, I think it was K&K Wrestle Factory, or perhaps it was yourself and Kelly, speaking about how sometimes it's difficult to know the story going in to a match, because that can bring a lot, especially with things like the Brian Tucker, Sean Johnson, which started even before the pandemic, with other stories that were kicking, like Damien's various defenses, having all that. And I thought, what if I did a show that was able to sort of bring all that together for people? So if they've never seen a show before, they have an idea of what to expect. They kind of know these characters now. And I asked one of the producers, like, can I do this? They just said, yes, just on you go. If you need a hand, just let us know. And actually this cupboard just over there, that's where I recorded a lot of the later ones. I think a lot of the early ones I just did sort of here, but I've got an actual recording cupboard over there that I filled with various bits of, like, this is from in there. There's jackets and things to sort of dull the noise. And that's where I recorded them all.
I really liked them, because I liked, like you're saying, I think it was probably K&K, because they were kind of out of the loop coming into these shows, and, you know, Kelly's there for just to see some wrestling, and I'm the big nerd that knows everything that's happening anyway. So, but yeah, you're right. It's always kind of been something that maybe WrestleZone aren't aren't as au fait with is their social media presence. So to have something like that, Talking Dawkins kind of, like I say, just caught up everyone. It's like a previously, it was only, what,
Yes, essentially, yeah.
5 and 10 minutes long. You were able to,
I think, 7 minutes was the usual. I tried to aim for that, about a minute per match. And then, of course, the Regal Rumble one was even longer because I had to talk about every individual who was in the Rumble.
But yeah, so like I say, could catch up a previously on WrestleZone. Here we go. I think I put a tweet out saying that I really liked it because in my head I just play like the din 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 din, like the run up to Royal Rumble season for Vince
I remember
McMahon.
my partner mentioned putting some copyright free music on it, but I decided against it. I decided to keep it just stripped down, just my voice, just the images, just to keep it as simple as possible, essentially.
That's it. Sometimes simple is always the best. That's why there's no background music when I'm doing these things. I'm like, no, that means I've got to actually edit something and I don't.
Yeah, and it could take away from what the people are saying because you're like, oh, that's nice music, but you're not actually listening to what they're saying.
Just zone out and just have a little boogie while you're trying to tell people why Brian Tucker and Sean Johnson are battering each other all the time. So, right, so that was for Chaos. So we'll wind back to Hijinks. Right, so your costume. So how was Halloween hijinks? It was Halloween time. Everyone was dressed up. Of course, James Chesser, the alternate referee, song commentary, dressed as NWO Sting. Wolfpack Sting, sorry.
Wolfpack Sting, yes.
Wolfpack Sting. I knew I would get, like, culled if I got that
Sting
wrong.
Has a lot of personas, to be fair.
He does. I like Sting when he wears a Sting mask, and then takes it off, and he's got
Excellent.
A Sting face.
Oh, it's just so good.
He's done it so many times now. I'm like, he knows this is silly, right? Mm-hmm. But I love it. It's just the best thing. Yeah. Joker Sting's also up there. Anyway, your costume. So, unfortunately, I thought it was Shrek.
A lot of people have said that, right? Even William Sterling knew it was a Shakespeare reference. He just said William Shakespeare, which is incorrect because, of course, Shakespeare had the ruff and the doublet and things like that. I was actually dressed as Hamlet from Act 3, Scene 1, the to be or not to be speech specifically. That was what I was aiming for.
Ah, right. I was going for, I mean, I'm not saying Shrek, but I'm saying Handsome Shrek from Shrek the Third.
Oh, yes, certainly. But no, it was Hamlet was what I was going for, certainly.
See, my only Hamlet reference is I read it in school. Of course, I was one of Rosencrantz or Guildenstern's, so, you know, top tier characters.
Or Guildenstern or Rosencrantz.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, whichever order you want to go in. It was one of them and, you know, had very few lines, which is great. Or just the Kenneth Branagh 4-hour version on DVD.
Oh, goodness. I've never seen it, but I certainly shall because it's completely, every line is in there. Every character is in there. There's nothing cut because a lot of course, Shakespeare adaptations cut characters, they cut lines. But that's just pure, unadulterated. This is everything William Shakespeare wrote in here. And I need to watch it because I know it'll be a fun time.
It was one of the few times where I found out that if you get a DVD and it's clear on both sides, you can flip it. Didn't know that was a thing until
I didn't know that Hamlet. Until you mentioned it right now.
Yeah, until I got Hamlet. Gone with the Wind was the other DVD that I found out that was a thing. But they never wrote. Well, I didn't see what side it was, so you had to kind of guess.
Yeah, so there was like a cassette tape where there's side A, side B.
Yeah, you just kind of put it in and just hope for the best. If it says intermission, you've chosen wrong, so you've got to go
flip it the other way.
You know, God, imagine if you had the VHS version. That must be like 4 VHSs if you were going to get that.
If I recall, Titanic was on 2 VHS tapes, as I recall, when it was released.
That's weird because they used to do that in WrestleMania as well, which I'm trying to reach. I've got the old WrestleMania 4 double.
Oh, goodness.
Double tape, signed by...
Which year is that? Number 4?
4.
That was the tournament, correct?
It was, yeah. And I got signed by Ted DiBiase.
Oh, fantastic.
First time I met him, you know. He's obviously a Scottish wrestling legend. He owns a company.
Of course, yes.
Right, okay. So, no, I'm not getting into that chat.
Despite me mentioning beforehand that I have no stories about back in those days, you still managed to somehow bring it around.
Found a way. It's amazing. It doesn't matter who I've got on, I can find a way to talk about that company and WrestleZone in any episode. It's incredible. It's a skill that only a wrestling fan I think has. That I don't know for yourself, if anyone brings up any topic, somehow you can get 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon back to
wrestling. I've noticed that more so now because at my Hall and Barrett near Tesco, I go there often. I've noticed I've started bringing up wrestling a lot to them because they're obviously very polite people. And I've started bringing up so much to them. I'm sure it's getting really annoying. And they're also really kind. They allow me to put my posters up for like any events we have coming up. So yeah, but wrestling comes up an awful lot, and I've somehow managed to bring it around to wrestling almost every conversation, and I don't know how I manage it.
Oh, it's an incredible skill. It's like you can just go, oh, I hurt my back, it was quite physical. Oh, speaking of physical, you know, I do some wrestling at the weekend.
Speaking of injured backs.
Exactly. Oh, you hurt your leg. Well, back in 1999, Sid Vicious jumped off the top of a top rope. And that was a hero.
No, thank you. No, thank you.
So it's quite incredible. It's an incredible skill that wrestling fans have, that we can just turn everything to wrestling.
I can do the same thing with Shakespeare as well.
I don't doubt that for a second. What's your favorite Shakespearean work?
Midsummer Night's Dream, because it's incredibly funny and it's incredibly influential, because Oberon and Titania as the fairy characters have such a wide reach. Of course, they originally came from Celtic lore, but they've had such a wide reach now. Their name, two of Uranus's moons are named after them. They've shown up in various video games, other works. I think they were in the Gargoyles Disney show, or Puck was anyway. And then you've got all the interweaving stories, like the Mechanicals, the theater troupe, the Athenian nobles, the four main characters sort of swinging around and being love drugged by the fairies, essentially. But every story weaves into the other in some way until eventually it all sort of comes up happy ending at the end. So probably Midsummer Night's Dream, almost certainly.
You find that like nowadays cinema is pretty much all in some way or form, they're all kind of linked back to Shakespearean works.
Certainly. But even then, Shakespeare's own work is all references to previous works. And of course, he wrote seven plays or something like that about kings who existed in real life, like Henry IV and Richard II and Richard III. Of course, these works aren't quite historically accurate, because of course he was writing them in the time of Elizabeth I. Richard III, as I recall, killed Elizabeth I's dad. So you don't want to portray that guy as a good guy. So he just turned him into this horrible villain, one of the best villains in theater, in performance, because he was writing it for Elizabeth I, basically.
Oh yeah. So yeah, play to your audience.
That's, exactly. That's precisely.
Works. But no, I was thinking of that because one of my favorite films is 10 Things I Hate About You, and it's very much based on The Taming of the Shrew.
Mm-hmm.
Which I knew it was a Shakespearean film, and I won't lie, I had to Google just to make sure that it was The Taming of the Shrew.
Taming of the Shrew is a lesser known play. It has a lot of misogynistic undertones, so it does not get played as much often without severe editing.
Right. But no, my Shakespeare is quite dull. I don't know a lot. Like, so outside of 4-hour Hamlet, I think that might have killed some passion for Shakespeare a little bit.
Unfortunately, it has that effect. Of course, you know, when you're as cultured as I am, eventually, intelligent as I am, I can understand all the references. I can bring everything in. It's a bit easier for me, I think.
So we had that. Halloween hijinks has passed. Talking Dawkins has begun. We're on the road to the Regal Rumble, and out of circumstance, you're getting a new opportunity. You're going to be ring announcing for the night, because Martin Clunas, the fair weather fan that he is down in Glasgow instead of a WrestleZone show. Disgusting.
Who would do that? Who would miss a WrestleZone show?
I know.
What sort of heinous villain would do such a thing?
I know. Absolute horrible people that do that sort of thing, to go to another place for another...
plague on both your houses.
But, unfortunately, COVID. Arrived.
A plague upon my house, a pox on me, as 'twere.
I know. What show did you miss? So how, like, was it just a thing that, because everyone tests in the morning, was it just bad luck,
yes,
or did you feel it at all?
Scotty Swift mentioned it on his little video he did, that we were chatting after training, that we were both very lucky to have not tested positive yet. And of course, that Saturday, Regal Rumble, one of our biggest shows of the year. It's a rumble. Rumbles are fantastic. We both get it. It's sod's lot. The universe runs on irony, I think. I did feel slightly ill beforehand, but I think it was just a cold, because I didn't test positive until the day. And then after that, I was like, oh, okay. This is bad.
So it was just one of those things. Because I've been lucky, touch wood, I have not caught it yet. Or at least I haven't noticed if I have. But, you know, as for 4 days of recordings, I put my throat down to that, but I might still take a test, just to be on the safe
side. Just to be safe, yeah, certainly.
Because, you know, what'll happen, I've got three next week. Once I finish, that'll be the time I get COVID. Like, the most inopportune time, that'll be the day. But, yeah, so did you, just, like, as soon as you knew, it was like, right, oh, no, my body's just, like, it's found out. I'm
yes, essentially. It was I think it was also part of disappointment of like being so hyped up for the show and then not being able to participate, knowing it was going on, knowing people were having a great time, being like, oh man, I wish I could have been a part of that. And I think that also played into it, because I think Scott mentioned the same thing of it felt so much worse, because I didn't feel that bad even after I tested positive. I just felt a bit more tired than usual, a bit more mentally down than usual. But I think at least the first day, most of that was, I'm so gutted that I'm missing the Regal Rumble. I'm absolutely livid.
And I mean, I'm not going to make it any better for you, but it was an amazing Rumble. I don't know. Have you watched it back yet? Have you?
I did. I think they were going over some commentary. I think there were some issues with the commentary, so they had to go back and do it. And of course, being the primary commentary guy, they brought me in to aid in the overseeing of that. So that's the first time I saw the show. And again, excellent performances by all.
Yeah, I mean, I apologize if it was just me shouting in the background noise.
I didn't hear you, honestly.
That's fine.
I just saw it. I didn't have any cans or anything, so I just saw the action itself.
Yeah, I'm very animated during the Rumble itself.
That's what you want.
I know. It's not often that I am animated during a show, but I've been told by other people that I've spoken to since that I was on the hard cam and very obvious and very animated and. Mm-hmm. Just head in my hands, crying at points, just because of the Rumble itself. But you know, that's wrestling.
That's wrestling.
Go enjoy it. But you know, it kind of worked out the best for you in some weird way.
In a way, in a roundabout way, yeah.
I mean, obviously, COVID's bad. That's not it goes without saying, obviously. But because of that, it kind of spurred you on to get your in-ring opportunity first at the Training Academy shows. So. I pretty much all my information there was secondhand from the notes that WrestleZone put out. So I don't know actually what the promo entailed or anything like that. But from what I understand, so this is your return after COVID. You got in the ring. You talked about your disappointment to not be at the Rumble, and then you called out Blue Thunder for a match at Aberdeen Anarchy because he took your spot at the at the commentary desk.
I think. Looking at it back in hindsight, I know it's less Thunder's fault. He was filling a role that would have been filled anyway. But I think it was a combination of being disappointed I missed the Rumble, having COVID and being out for it, and also having trained for 5 years. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot in my head, the producers had decided that was where I was. And I wasn't going to just sit there and be forgotten about.
Yeah.
So I wanted to make sure that I staked my claim and made sure that everyone of the fans, everyone in the back knows I'm the most intelligent professional wrestler on this side of the globe, and I will not let these opportunities pass me by any longer. And luckily, WrestleZone have seen reason and have allowed me to. They allowed me to perform at Aberdeen Anarchy.
I mean, especially when it's a 10-match card, it was kind of teased. It wasn't like explicitly said it was going to be 10 matches, but generally. When it comes to, I did my own calculations. I knew it was going to be 4-4, and then they announced 2 VIP matches. So I was like, right, 10 matches.
A very long show, but the crowd never seemed to be tired or burned out, which
honestly,
is excellent.
Honestly, didn't realize the time had passed so much. Mm-hmm. It was just an amazing night. Unsurprisingly, I'm heaping praise on it because I mean, everyone, if you haven't watched the 150th episode of my road trip, you'll see I'm spent by the time the show ends. I'm just done emotionally. But so there's 10 matches. That's arguably at least 20 spots on that show.
If it was just 1v1, yes.
Yeah, so at least 20 spots. So of course you got there. You were on the pre-show, the pre-show main event.
That's how I like to think about it, yes.
Against Blue Thunder. And you know what? I came into this as, like, when it comes to WrestleZone trainees as well, very rarely is their first match not good. It seems to be solid, and then once they get back, once they're on shows properly for a couple months, they're just like the amazing. Recently though, I don't know what the guys at WrestleZone are feeding you, is because Evan Young's debut was incredible. The first time I saw Rodan King, it was Summer Hill Showdown, and he was just like the complete wrestler.
He was amazing.
He was definitely amazing. Maybe an extra word in there somewhere, but he was definitely amazing.
Strong words from Ronan King, is I believe what I said on commentary.
You know, and yeah, I'm still the only person that didn't hear it at the time. I don't understand it how. So you had that, and then of course yourself. And I don't know if you read the review of the show, or no, I did do
I did, I when it
review.
came out, so I don't really remember it, unfortunately.
Well, I mean, I can get it, but I mean, we don't want to embarrass you with me
Oh
just
no,
saying so
please.
many nice things. You know what? I will get it. Right. But in the
All good.
meantime, yeah, I was just so surprised at how complete a wrestler you were. I mean, I was very much, I knew you'd probably have the crowd work kind of stuff down because I not that I know everything about you, but I know you did like you do a voice work, of course, the Talking
Yes.
Dawkins and what have you, and you've got a bit of theater background as well. So I was very aware that you were gonna, at least if you couldn't walk the walk, you were gonna talk the talk at the very least. And then suddenly this guy, this is shocking. I really should be able to do this. I should know where to find these things. But no, it I was just, I just couldn't believe how good you were. I
Thank
mean,
you. I appreciate
yeah.
that.
Right. Let's find this. What did I say? So it's supposed to be just thoughts. I end up just writing paragraph after paragraph about this, about yourselves. Let's see. Oh, I didn't really much write too many things. But I was just saying, yeah. And right, I said you and Thunder created entertaining art was the kind of way I put it. But go back to your attire first. So
Oh yes.
it was quite like a, it's like a one piece kind of thing with
It's
the.
actually it's a it is a it was a shirt which I removed the sleeves of, and some tights that I purchased from Decathlon from the women's extra large section. I do have other tights that I purchased that were specifically designed for me, but the color didn't quite come the way I expected. So
Right.
I was doing some training with Scotty Swift, and he said, "See if you can find something that's a bit more darker." And I'm like, "Okay." So I found those tights, and they became part of my look, and I'm like, "Oh, these are perfect." So I stuck with that, and that is so far how I've stuck with it. I mean,
And
eventually, once I have a bit more money, to be quite honest with you, I would like to get more tights made up, more in that style that are more distinctly Rhys Dawkins.
I'll get a couple of wins, get some of the winner's purse.
Oh, precisely, yes.
Exactly. What was the, so was it just, did you have the shirt with the old ruffle collar
The
thing?
ruffles, they're miles away. I would go get them, but they're
But
miles and miles
did you
away.
have it all together and then she realized, no, I'm gonna get really warm in this. I'll keep the ruffles around the collar and just take
Oh,
out
the
the
ruffs are
sleeves.
a separate thing. I
All
purchased
right,
the
okay.
ruffs individually. I actually, there are, because most wrestlers use wrist tape, but instead I thought, oh, what if I get some sweatbands? And my partner's mother does a lot of sewing, so I asked her to sew the ruffs onto the sweatbands. So that's why I was going to go get them to show you exactly how they look, but they're miles away, so I'm not going to bother.
I'm more impressed that there was I thought it was literally just some ruffles that you put on. I like that there's a bit more like
Oh
stability
yes,
to them.
a lot of finding who I should be comes with mixing the Shakespearean intelligence aspect with I'm a professional wrestler aspect, because if you go too much one way or too much the other, there's a disconnect and people don't invest as much. Whereas if you manage to nail both halves well enough and have a good cohesion, people are more willing to sort of accept, oh, that's the Shakespeare wrestler.
Absolutely, and I liked the crowd itself. I mean, like I'm not the most intelligent man in the world, and I will admit that. But I like that we were just a little bit thick in comparison. To be honest, we were just like as you're shouting, you and Thunder were even doing Shakespearean references back and forth, and we were all just going, assume that's Shakespeare. It's
My horse, a kingdom for a horse.
I got that one.
Whilst I was wrenching back on Thunder's neck, was a personal favorite of mine.
I know if it's not a last periodic, I knew him well, Horatio. I'm like a bit sketchy. You know, Hamlet has to
Of
be.
course, yes.
It's the only one I know. But yeah, so I like that like little bit of patter, lack of a better word. I can't think of a better word for it. Chanter,
Education.
education, education. Yeah, there we go. So did you find that was important just to go all in on your Shakespearean experiences? Just go for it.
Certainly. I felt like a lot of professional wrestlers and wrestlers are great, some of the best wrestlers in the country. I had to find a way to differentiate myself from them and to make people fully aware I am the most intelligent professional wrestler on this roster. And finding my link through Shakespeare was essentially my way to do that, to sort of differentiate myself and find an easy in for me to be able to transition to an in-ring competitor was finding a way to link the Shakespeare to the wrestling. which I found in being more intelligent than the other wrestlers.
And of course, you use some of that intelligence to take off the turnbuckle and throw Thunder's face on it. What I liked, though, is you put the turnbuckle back.
Of course.
I mean, not just for the intelligence side of things, but just more for a tidy sort of side of things.
You have to make sure that your set is all nice and prepared and ready to be used at a moment's notice. Everything belongs in its place. Turnbuckle pad belongs on the turnbuckle.
Absolutely. So how would you find the match then? So afterwards, I'm assuming, I don't know if you're a perfectionist or a pessimist perfectionist kind of thing, every match is going to be bad until that one day. Or did you look back and go, you know what, I'm happy with it?
The crowd reacted how I wanted them to. The physical stuff went, there were a few touchy moments, I won't lie. Even in the moment, I thought, oh, okay, that could have gone a little bit better on my end. Looking back on it, there's even more that has come up from rewatches and speaking with the trainers and things like that. But certainly a competent match. The crowd reacted how we needed them to, and that's all we can really ask for.
That's it. Exactly. I mean, like we were saying about wrestling in general, it's sometimes less about the wrestling and more about the character, and you
certainly
provided the character. Even if the wrestling in your mind needs a bit of a lift and what have you, but the character kind of overrode anything with that. And like I was saying, it's just, I like you had the little things. It's all about the little things when it comes to wrestling. Like I said, your timing as well. I found your timing so great. And this is someone who just watches it. I've watched it for long enough to know what is good and what's possibly not good. But then I've got to keep it in my mind going, well, it's still subjective. So
yes, of course.
I think Adam's not totally sold on Rhys Dawkins yet in his review, but whereas I'm like, yeah, I get this.
The quote I like to use is, if the lion listened to every sheep that begged for its life, the lion would starve.
That's a nice way to put it. I like that. I like this is more, I feel like this is a more intelligent podcast just for yourself on it.
I mean, what else did you expect?
True. Absolutely. That's yeah, absolutely. And here I am, speechless. Right, so we got that, and of course it's gala season. So now you're getting a bit more.
I was present at Newburgh Gala. I don't know if people will have seen by this point. Vago's mosh pit went up. He said he spoke to everyone except Omar. I was also there, and I don't appreciate being forgotten about, Mickey Vago. But I will ensure that you won't forget about me again.
I did watch it. I was literally, that's why you were in waiting room for like a minute longer than
I was watching it, and then the post went up. I'm like, I'll finish this later.
Yeah. I just watched the end of it and just saw that you are spotted in the battle royal at the end. There's a little bit of a clip of it. So you're officially in the mosh pit. Now you just need to actually be in the mosh pit.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe Vigo will get a 2022 tour shirt out, and I'll have Rhys Dawkins on the back of it somewhere. I could
live with that, certainly. I posted many moons ago, when everyone was getting shirts, my own mock-up shirt that is never going to be made because I made it on my phone with using my finger, so that will not be released.
But I mean, of course, it's early days, but is there some Shakespearean merch ideas that you could get quills with Rhys Dawkins on it?
Whilst I'm sure that could eventually become a thing later on, the main thing I'm working on just now is making sure that I am performing to the best of my ability, and I'm still in a learning process.
Mm-hmm.
My primary focus at the moment is learning, being more comfortable in front of a crowd, being more comfortable doing what I'm doing, and proving that I am the most intelligent professional wrestler on this side of the globe before worrying about anything outside of that right now.
Fair enough. So, like I said, gala season, is it just... you're just happy to be wrestling after 5 years of waiting between leg breaks and COVID and that? Is it just,
I believe,
everything you wanted and more?
At the moment, I'm currently available for every gala. So if you ever find yourself nearby a gala or wanting to go to a gala where wrestling's present, you will probably see me there. Again, as part of my learning to continue doing what I'm doing, trying to improve every time that I can, being a part of the galas is an important part of that because it's less rigid than a show. As Vago said in the mosh pit, there's more of a flow, more of a fun atmosphere than a show day where there's stress of, okay, here is your match, this is what you'll do, essentially, this is where you are, there's less of a structure. there's slight structure, but there's certainly less of it. And also you've got a crowd who don't necessarily know wrestling or like wrestling, but they're just there because it's something to do. Newborough Gala, as Vago said, was incredibly hot. There was a large crowd for it, which I didn't expect. I'm not sure, the upcoming one on the 18th, it'll be done by the time this goes up, unfortunately, is Old Meldrum, Highland Games, I believe. And that's an upcoming one. And I believe there's one like Duthie Park and things like that. They'll be posted on the WrestleZone page, I'm sure.
That's what I was about to say. It's like when it is a bit more looser because people haven't paid to see the wrestling. That's not what they've come to see. So you're just there to kind of go, right.
Play a role, essentially.
You're going to put on a show, and if you like what you see, come to the next show. Mm-hmm. And then when you pay your money, you're like, right, this is, people are paying to see us now. We've got to actually do the entertaining part. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's just a loose thing. I'm hoping, like, I say it every time there was like a Jubilee thing in Elgin, and I was laughing because we're walking around and see all these car shows and there's some gymnastics and all that kind of stuff, and I was like going, no, what's missing?
A bit of wrestling
would be ace here. This is just brilliant for it. And they started calling the wee bit where everyone was going to in the ring there's gymnastics, and I was like, a ring? And
it's a fake ring.
Oh no, it's just little girls doing gymnastics. This is weird. I'm gonna just move on and just go get ice cream or something. But no, that's what it says. So Elgin, if anyone from the Rotary Club, get some wrestling on. People will love it. Honestly, I will, and that's the most important thing.
Oh, certainly.
So that's kind of, we're kind of up to date with your in ring and journey at this stage in wrestling. So we've got some questions,
we'll do
your hopes and dreams for the future as well. Mm-hmm. And then we'll finish it all. We'll do the social media stuff, and then we'll end with a nice bit of Shakespeare to close it. So Ronan King sent us a couple of questions.
Yes, I'm aware.
He asked, you're just going to be disappointed for both of them. Is Shakespeare the one who wrote the play that Taylor Swift refers to in her song Love Story?
So I mentioned this earlier. Shakespeare, of course, indeed wrote a lot of he was an innovator, but he did take from other places. So Shakespeare's, I'm going to have to read off my phone. I was going to be incredibly intelligent and just know it's off the top of my head. I haven't learned it, so I'm just going to read it instead. Shakespeare's principal source for the plot of Romeo and Juliet was the tragical history of Romeo and Juliet, a long narrative poem written in 1562 by Arthur Brooks, who had based his poem on a French translation of a tale by the Italian writer Matteo Bandello. So the truth of the matter is, Taylor Swift, also, it's not a love story, it's a tragedy, because they all die at the end. So it's hard to have a happy ending that's a love story when everyone dies. Probably a more appropriate song would have been Love Story based on Midsummer Night's Dream, for example, or The Merry Wives of Windsor, something like that. But as I understand it, yes, Taylor Swift based her song, or at least based certain lyrics on her song, on the modern understanding of Romeo and Juliet, is what I call it.
So not only is Ronan King getting called out here, Taylor Swift's getting a little bit called out for her inaccuracies calling it Love Story when it wasn't.
I don't care what your relation is to Scotty Swift. You need to have your own understandings of Shakespearean plays. It's very important for culture.
Totally. And we've got Ronan King. Were you inspired to use your intelligence in wrestling after seeing Ronan King put on many a performance using his massive brain?
So Ronan King, he does have a large body part, but it's not his brain, it's his mouth. And okay, I think at some point, if it probably already has, it's going to get him in trouble. And in fact, it already has, because whenever he makes a mistake on Twitter, I am very quick to point out his grammatical and spelling errors, because you've got to kind of understand this thing. You know, social media, this is your people's first gateway into who Ronan King is through social media. And if you're making simple errors in spelling, people are going to think, oh, he's an idiot. Whether that's true of Ronan King or not, I'm not entirely sure, but I know he doesn't want to appear that way.
I mean, Ronan King has admitted it himself that Ronan King is not the best wrestler.
Exactly, precisely.
Oh, never has a tweet never has a tweet been regretted so much.
this is what I'm saying about him having a big mouth. Sometimes you need to keep your, I had a quote for this as well, but I cannot quite remember it now. I think I mentioned it before my appearance at the Academy show. Oh darn, I can't remember it now. It was on my Twitter, I'm fairly certain. sometimes a single voice piercing the silence is louder than a sonic boom or something like that.
Right. Quote for all seasons.
Absolutely.
Rhys Dawkins. So that was the questions we got through. I've got my two questions, which seems which is going to really bring the tone down, I think, for the whole thing as we're talking about intelligent things like Shakespeare and the like. And I'm going to go, what's your favorite dinosaur?
So a lot of people would say Tyrannosaurus Rex. Of course, it's the large one, or Velociraptor, courtesy of the Jurassic Park movies. However, my favorite dinosaur actually is something called a Carnotaurus. So, of course, Carno comes from the word carnivorous, which means meat eater. And Taurus, of course, comes from the Pokemon from the first generation, who's a bull.
Ah, there we go.
So, meat-eating bull.
Just looking it up now. Oh, that is a wee terrifying thing.
I do like a Carnotaurus. I had a book of dinosaurs when I was a youth that I would peruse often, and Carnotaurus was always my favorite. There's also a creature known as an Andrusarchus, which was a prehistoric mammal. It was like a giant wolf, and they'd essentially created the entire dinosaur from just its jaw or just its skull. It was very impressive. To see what people can, almost the imagination of people who are able to take a skull and then create this entire creature around it, create this entire story around it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to find the play that I'm wanting to quote from.
Yeah. I'm just looking at this Carnotaurus. How does it run? That's like a chicken. It's like a big
chickens chicken. Are predecessors to dinosaurs, of course.
Yeah, but that's the most chickeny dinosaur I've ever seen, just because, like, just really small arms.
Mm-hmm.
A new guy looks like that. That's the dinosaur question out of the way. Another one, of course, is the classic, what would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Well, now that depends on what kind of sheep and cow you're talking about, because of course there are certain kinds of sheep that have incredibly large horns, but there are also sheep that are quite bulky and fluffy, so they would have a lot more defensive capabilities. A bull, speaking of, also it depends on whether it's a bull or a cow. Cows, of course, like a dairy cow, that doesn't have any horns, so it's limited in the attack variety. It's also generally got udders, which is a target for any sheep who may be involved. A Highland cow, probably a bit more aggressive, probably a bit more violent. Also, they can't see anything because they've got, of course, the hair covering the eyes. And you've also got two sheep, though, and the numbers game plays in a lot with that.
Mm-hmm.
So I probably go with, but again, it depends, because if it's two incredibly domesticated sheep are incredibly lazy. So even if they've got horns, even if they've got all this aggressive tension, they're incredibly lazy animals, so they might just not bother. For the purposes of answering your question, I'm going to go with two sheep because they have the numbers advantage and probably a bit faster than a cow as well, generally, especially if they're sheared.
Wonderful. I love the thought that people put into this question.
You're more than welcome, William.
It's excellent. It's the more thought, the better. I mean, I don't mind people just going, just picking one or another, but I like it when I get a little bit of reasoning for the picking.
Reasoning.
Oh, there we go. Wonderful.
I don't do enough puns.
I do love a pun. That's, any of them is always good. So that's my silly questions out of the way. We've done the online questions. We've done your wrestling journey so far. So let's look into the future. Of course, you're still early on. You've had your one main show match or mm-hmm. pre-show main event match, and you've had your gala matches as well, or match or matches. Is there anyone that you're seeing, whether on the WrestleZone roster, whether in the UK in general, is there anyone out there that you're thinking, I would love to do a bit of wrestling with them?
I listened to Zach Dynamite's interview earlier, and he mentioned not putting too much expectation on yourself, or too much, too much sort of hoping against hope, almost, to sort of trying. There is, of course, the essence of manifesting. People want to manifest things into existence, so they say them out loud in order to sort of build that sort of connection to the event. At the moment, I'm just trying to improve myself, like I mentioned earlier, improve my performance in my professional wrestling. So I'm trying not to think too much about who I would like to wrestle. Anyone in particular? So many of the WrestleZone guys are some of the best wrestlers in the UK, and I'd be honored to step into the ring with them. Scotty Swift, as a trainer of myself, I'd like to get into the ring with him at some point, show him how much I've learned, but also how much he doesn't know about me yet. Of course, Zach Dynamite, Ryan Riley, Bruiser Brad. I'm not sure how far away that would be in the future. They've already just laid the foundations. Also a fun fact, when the Foundation of the Future won their titles, I put a haiku on my Twitter. Nobody has commented on it. So shows the level of intelligence that I have above most of the folk who who come to our shows.
And put out there, Mr. P, just because he's a teacher.
Mr. P is another man. I mean, yes.
You have to have some sort of intelligence to teach. So I think
to be fair,
quite,
do you know what he teaches?
It's technical, but still.
I mean,
it's still some sort of. You have to have some intelligence there.
It's not English, though, is it? It's not drama, though, is it?
Sure, but I mean, some of my technical teachers were very intelligent. They had to hide bottles and all that kind of stuff. And you know, we spray.
Tells you everything you need to know, doesn't it? But yeah, Mr. P, I'm sure it was posted I think it was when COVID first started. The Evening Express did a piece on WrestleZone returning, and Mr. P and I were tasked with doing some wrestling in order to sort of showcase it and have the photos taken. I always like to call it the Evening Express Derby. Yeah, I'm sure you can find that on the website of the Evening Express. I'm sure it's there.
So for people to find it. I'm guessing there'll be the same kind of answer for companies. You just kind of want to establish yourself in WrestleZone.
Precisely, yes. WrestleZone is my main home just now. I have no intention of putting my name out there for anyone just yet. If a company watches this and think, oh, Rhys Dawkins would be an excellent addition to our company, I'm more than willing to listen to you if you DM me on Twitter, but I'm not going to be reaching out to anyone until I feel like I've established myself a little bit more, till I understand myself a bit more, understand the business a little bit more.
Is there any like mini goals you've got? Is it like wrestling in Ellen? Is that kind of like a mini goal?
Wrestling in Ellen is one, primarily because it's my hometown. Mm-hmm. So I know that the people would be more than willing to see what someone from Ellen can do. Essentially, they don't have to be stuck in a town where nothing happens. They can make something of themselves, and I would be living proof of that. Mm-hmm. I'd like to perform in the main card of Aberdeen Anarchy at some point. Of course, I have many years of wrestling ahead of me. Mm-hmm. And with Crusher Crabe, of course, retiring at Aberdeen Anarchy, there's more spaces for the young talent to get involved. So there's going to be more spaces at Aberdeen Anarchy, hopefully. If I've established myself enough, if people want to see Rhys Dawkins, they will be able to see me on the main card of Aberdeen Anarchy.
Wonderful. Right, so that's the future stuff. We do have a fantasy question that we ask everyone now this season. Vince McMahon's phoned you. He's DM'd you. He likes a bit of
Hello?
Shakespeare. He likes a bit of Shakespeare. Yeah, he does a soliloquy and gets you on board.
That's very impressive, Vince. Very impressive.
He says, Rhys, I want to book you in the main event at WrestleMania. You absolutely everything. So you get to choose the match, the opponent, the stipulations, whether it's a singles match, a tag team match, fatal four way. I don't care. It's your choice. Mm-hmm. Who's in that match?
See, when you have no limitations, the entire world is open to you, and suddenly you're smothered in choice almost. If I had to pick anyone, it would probably be one of the men who originally got me into pro wrestling, which was Rey Mysterio, and the match would have to be No Holds Barred.
Wonderful. Not an eye for an eye.
Oh, certainly not. Oh, goodness, no. That was terrible.
Wonderful. So Rey Mysterio versus Rhys Dawkins, main event at WrestleMania, No Holds Barred.
Oh, just in case you didn't understand the pun, it's B-A-R-D, not B-A-R-R-E-D. No Holds Barred.
Okay, I'm going to hang on.
It's a Shakespeare reference, William.
Hang on, I'll get it. Just give me a moment. I'll absolutely
I've managed to find my section now, so I'm just going to leave that page open.
Ah, right. The Bard.
Yes. Bard of Stratford-upon-Avon.
I've got it.
I have the intention of actually visiting Stratford-upon-Avon later this year with my partner. So I'll be able to fully embrace the Shakespearean air and be able to come back an even more intelligent being. Probably Wonderful. By the next time you see me.
I'm sure. I'm hoping to get to Battle of Nations. But, you know, that's a little bit of a dodgy time. Because
of course, yes.
Certainly. Due at the end of that month. So I'm like, oof, maybe not. But who knows? Maybe I'll see you. Maybe Rhys Dawkins will wrestle Battle of Nations, and I'll be able to witness you on a main show as well.
I think WrestleZone would be foolish to not have Rhys Dawkins wrestling at Battle of the Nations.
Absolutely. So before we end with our lovely piece of Shakespearean scripture, where can people find out more about Rhys Dawkins on the social media?
Twitter, you can find me at Rhys_Dawkins. You can also find me on Facebook. I believe it is just at Rhys Dawkins. Let me have a look because I didn't prepare this. Yes, you should be able to find me at Rhys Dawkins on the Facebook as well. I don't currently have an Instagram. just follow the wrestlers on Instagram, and I'm sure I'll be popping up every now and again, especially with the gala season coming up. Those are the main two, Twitter and the Facebook there. Facebook's also where you'll find the archived Talking Dawkins from before, if you want a little bit of a catch-up as we head into the next year of WrestleZone shows.
Excellent. So to close us out then, we've got Rhys Dawkins with a little bit of Shakespeare.
This is A Midsummer Night's Dream, which I've mentioned earlier in the show, of course. This is Act 5, Scene 1, the final soliloquy of the play. If we shadows have offended, think but this, and all is mended. That you have but slumbered here whilst these visions did appear. And this weak and idle theme, no more yielding but a dream. Gentles, do not reprehend. If you pardon, we will mend. And as I am an honest puck, if we have unearned luck, now to scape the serpent's tongue, we will make amends ere long. Else the puck a liar call. So, good night unto you all. Give me your hands if we be friends, and Robin shall restore amends.
Wonderful.